Hello, everyone, and welcome to PCA and Dove's Body Confidence Sport webinar, the second of a three-part series where we'll be diving into aspects of the new resource that Dove has co-created with Nike, aimed to revolutionize the sports experience for young female athletes and build body confidence in girls globally. My name is Marty Reed Love, and I am the Director of National Partnerships and DEI Programming Manager for Positive Coaching Alliance. And our vision is to build a world where every child benefits from a positive youth sports experience with a coach who inspires them to become the best version of themselves in the game and in life. So thank you all for being here and joining us. We have an excellent panel that I will introduce in a moment. But first, I want to cue the Body Confidence Sports video so you all have a better idea of what this entire thing is about.
Hi there. Welcome to our global community committed to creating body confident athletes, coaches, and sport environments. I'm Dr. Emily Matheson from the Center for Appearance Research, and I specialize in body image and sport, as well as creating global youth development programs. But more importantly, I'm an athlete who has experienced the countless benefits of playing a sport that I love, as well as feeling part of something greater than myself. 20 years of research consistently shows that young people who identify as girls drop out of sport because they're worried about how they look when taking part. These worries stem from societal pressures that suggest girls should look and act a certain way when they're playing sport. That is, they should be tall, thin, have just the right amount of muscle, as well as play sports that are viewed as traditionally feminine, such as dance, gymnastics, or volleyball. But the reality is, every body and every type of body can be an athlete. Body Confidence Sport is a global initiative that aims to stop girls dropping out of sport because of body image concerns. It includes two programs, Body Confident Coaching and Body Confident Athletes. These two programs were designed collaboratively between girls and coaches with leading experts and brands in body image and sport. They're also informed by the latest scientific research, as well as tested and proven to work. Body Confident Coaching is a web-based self-guided program that provides coaches with the knowledge and skills to create positive body environments for their athletes. Meanwhile, Body Confident Athletes is an in-person, coach-led program that provides girls with the knowledge and skills to feel body confident when playing the sport that they love. And now you're part of this global community, and together we are going to help girls thrive in sport and beyond.
We are so excited about this resource that is available for you to download. I will be putting up a QR code at the end of the webinar so you can download the resources. But I also want you to understand that we'll be focusing on the second session of the Body Confident Athlete Program, where athletes learn how to focus on and accept what their bodies can do and experience during sport rather than what it looks like. By shifting their focus, athletes are more likely to accept and appreciate their different abilities and be in tune with their body and what their body needs when playing sports. So I'm excited for today's webinar. We are recording this. We will be sending a recap out after as well, but so glad that you all are here tuning in today. So now without further ado, let's meet today's panelists. We have Samantha Pejic, a 2008 Olympic silver medalist, 2007 world champion gold medalist, three-time NCAA champion, and 17-time All-American for UCLA Gymnastics. She's now a broadcaster for the NCAA and the founder and CEO of Beam Queen, a camp and community where she helps young gymnasts gain confidence through understanding the balance beam. Thank you, Sam, so much for joining us. Next, we have Natasha Watley. She is a two-time Olympic medalist for USA softball, three-time world champion, Hall of Fame shortstop, ambassador for Major League Baseball, and the driving force behind the Natasha Watley Foundation, a community service nonprofit dedicated to introducing softball to young girls of the nation's inner cities and from low-income households. And I have to publicly give her her flowers, as she is the sole reason why I chose to pursue softball and grew up, you know, in the inner cities, watching and looking up to Natasha Watley as a softball player and beyond. So thank you so much, Tasha, for being here and your commitment to youth sports and gender equity. And next, we have Kathy Rinaldi, who needs no introduction. She is a tennis icon, started at 14 and quickly became a top 10 professional tennis player in both singles and doubles. She's reached the semifinals of all Grand Slam events in singles, doubles, or mixed categories. Currently the head of women's tennis for the USTA Player Development, and she's the Olympic head coach for the 2020 Tokyo and 2024 Paris Games. So thank you so much, Kathy, for joining us. Now, as you see, we've got esteemed former players and coaches, and I'm really excited to introduce our final panelists, Dr. Philippa Diedrichs, professor of psychology, body image, and mental health expert. Dr. Philippa is an award-winning researcher and consultant known internationally for developing and evaluating evidence-based strategies to improve body image and mental health in digital community, corporate, and policy settings. And she's a major influence and contributor to the work that we're going to be diving into today. And so I'm so excited that she's here. Thank you so much, Dr. Diedrichs, for your impactful involvement and taking part in today's discussion as well. So thank you all for being here. So let's dive in. I want to get started with the Q&A. And of course, those that are tuning in, be sure to utilize the Q&A chat box to ask any questions. We'll try to get to them as well. But in the tools, we specifically describe body functionality as when we focus on and appreciate what bodies can do and experience, and perhaps what they do differently to others, rather than focusing on what it looks like. So in what ways does a strong connection to body functionality enhance an athlete's overall sports performance and enjoyment? Let's start with Dr. Philippa, and others can chime in after to provide any specific examples.
Thanks, Marty. And it's so great to be here with everyone today, talking about body confidence sport, a labor of love from me and my team and the teams at Dove and Nike and the Tucker Center for Women and Girls in Sport for 3 years now. And body functionality is a really key and important component of having body confidence. Often when we talk about body confidence, we focus a lot or hear a lot about worrying about the way that we look. And certainly our attitudes and opinions and our feelings and behaviors in relation to our appearance and how we look is a core component of body image. But the other core component that often doesn't get as much attention is body functionality, which, as Marty really nicely described, is what our bodies can do and all of their functions. So initially, when we think about body functionality, and particularly in the movement context or sport context, one aspect of body functionality is, of course, how we move our bodies. So that might be how we move our bodies when we're playing sport. It could also be how we're moving our bodies in our everyday life. So, for example, I'm talking to you right now using my hands to gesture and to communicate. That is an aspect of my body functionality as well, how we communicate. It also affects our relationships. So for example, I will use my body to hug my loved ones to show connection. And also it's our five senses. So how, you know, what we see, what we're hearing, what we're touching, what we're smelling, and what we're sensing in our bodies. And then also a crucial component of it is the functions of our body in terms of how our bodies heal and process things. So cell renewal, how our muscles respond after a workout, for example. The fact that as we're sitting here right now, our bodies are doing all of these amazing things to potentially digest our food. They're automatically breathing so that we can continue to talk. Our hearts are beating. You know, I've been a little bit sick over the past week, so my immune system is firing and trying to heal. And finally, our body functionality also helps in terms of the other interests that we might have in our lives. So how we use our bodies for creativity, for the work that we do, et cetera. So why it's so important when when it comes to sport and movement and athletes in particular, obviously the movement aspect is really crucial. So it's really important that athletes have a connection to their bodies, both when they're playing and performing, but also outside of the performance setting. So it's really listening to how your body is feeling. Is it pain barriers? Is it feeling tense? Does it need a period of recovery? Are you not reaching your full potential and can you push it a little bit more? So you can see how being in tune with your body is really important as an athlete to both your performance, but also your recovery and potentially to your enjoyment of doing it. Because if your body is always feeling horrible, that's going to be something that really prevents you from engaging and participating. Why it's really important to also focus on body functionality when it comes to girls in particular and women in sporting and movement settings is we know that low body confidence is the leading barrier to girls, adolescent girls dropping out of sport. And they're dropping out of sport at twice the rate of boys, which is what we've seen in Dove and Nike's research last year, as well as lots of other scientific research. And what we hear from girls, and our team has spoken to thousands of girls and coaches around the world, but there's also dozens of studies which have looked at this, is that girls report that unrealistic standards for what an athlete should look like, or what a sporty person looks like, or a high performing athlete looks like, is a barrier to them. If they don't meet those standards, they feel that they're not going to fit in and they withdraw. So irrespective of what their body is functioning and doing, if they're not looking like that, they can feel pressure. Comments and commentary from other people on their appearance. And in some instances, our appearance and our bodies and the composition of our bodies can affect performance. But there are also many myths around that as well. And if you look at us, you know, I always think we've got some amazing Olympians on this call. If you look at, you know, if you went to the opening ceremony at the Olympics and you looked at all the different. There isn't this idea that there's one way that an athlete, we focus on body functionality, we shift the attention from how we look to focusing on what our bodies can do and listening to our body's needs. We reduce that objectification. We reduce the idea that we're objects to be looked at by other people. And as a result of that, we can focus on our bodies as tools and instruments that help us move through life and perform in sporting settings. We're also more likely to be able to listen to our bodies, which is a core component of body confidence, which is crucial when you're performing or playing sport to doing it well, but also just to enjoying the experience. And you're more likely to honor that because you're in touch with it and aware of what's going on. And you're more likely to then prioritize your body's needs and what it feels rather than listening to other people, which ultimately these intrinsic reasons for engaging in movement and sport are the things that keep girls in sport in the long term.
That is such excellent insights there. I would love to hear from the other panelists. If you have any personal experiences where you listened to your body and it impacted your performance or your enjoyment out there on the playing field.
Marty, I'll just add that I think Philippa brought up some really great points there. And I think it's important to understand our bodies. I'm never going to be 6 feet tall, but I'm going to focus on my strengths. And maybe my strength might be quickness, whereas someone, you know, in tennis, which is really important, and maybe someone else who's a little bit taller might be a little bit stronger, or, you know, maybe I have a little bit more stamina. So I think it's important for us as coaches and as players that we recognize that. And when working with younger players and up and coming players, that we focus on their strengths. I think that's extremely important.
Yes, absolutely. Anyone else wanted to add anything there?
I know we're probably going to dive into the comparisons and the body image jealousy in terms of teammates, but my coach did a really amazing job with our group, and I was a gymnast, and there's a lot of body image conversations around the sport of gymnastics because you're wearing a leotard and you need to be as lean as possible, right? And it really didn't become, you know, a thing, because I think that our coaches never made it a thing. And so, you know, thinking about all of these questions of like, what did our coaches say and do to prolong it becoming a thing? That's inevitable, I think, in girls in puberty and when you get to high school. But when I was a younger athlete, it was really important for communication to our coach. And so when we talk about functionality, if we had an injury or a soreness, they wanted to know. And so I think for a lot of young athletes, just being able to identify, like, am I feeling a 10 out of 10 today? Am I a little sore from yesterday? Or is this a little bit bigger and it's been sore a few days and maybe it's going to turn into an injury? So starting to think about high level of like, how can you identify what your body is feeling and what your body is capable of? Because in terms of looking back in my career, I know that I was only able to get to my potential because I immediately backed off when I did have an injury. So recognizing your body and knowing, is this an injury or is this soreness, or do I feel amazing to push myself? Exactly what Dr. Philippa had to say.
Thank you for that, Sam, as well. Do you have something else to add, Kathy?
I did, because I think Sam brings up that those are great points. And, you know, obviously now working with our athletes at the USTA National Tennis Center, we have a well-being app. So, you know, it's for the players to tell us how they slept, how they're feeling. Are they feeling stressed? You know, there's a lot of things outside the playing field that goes on. You know, they still have lives. They still have issues outside of tennis and softball and, you know, gymnastics. So, you know, homework and boyfriends and things like that come into play. So we like to check on them on their well-being. And it's also a lot of educating, I think, with the younger athletes so that they know, like Sam said, she knew how her body felt. And sometimes the young athletes, they don't quite know what is sore and what is an injury. So, you know, it's incredible to have a great performance team around the coaches as well, with strength and conditioning, nutrition, athletic medicine, sports analytics, mental skills, so that we can, you know, work with these young athletes and educate them and educate their private coaches and educate their parents as well, which is very important.
Absolutely. Having the access to the proper resources and tools around us, as well as communication. I hear you all loud and clear. Communication is key. Checking in with your athletes, even asking them, how do you feel? How did your body feel today on a scale of 1 to 10? You know, making sure you're staying on top of those things and being very communicative. Now, Sam, you mentioned something that was really important as well. And it has me thinking, you know, society, peers, and oftentimes family members can be, you know, very hyper focused on how girls look, and it has a major impact on how we view ourselves oftentimes. I remember growing up in sports and, you know, as an athlete, I always had very defined arms and shoulders, and I would get teased relentlessly if I wore tank tops. Kids would say, oh, here comes the gun show, or, you know, here's guns, or, you know, man arms. They call me these names and things like that, to the point where I could not wear clothes that showed my arms for many, many years. I refused to wear anything that showed my arms or my shoulders. And I know there's athletes out there that might be going through something similar. So how can athletes start to shift their mindset from focusing on their appearance to embracing and appreciating the functional capabilities of their bodies during sports? Sam, let's start with you.
Yeah, man, this is a tough one, because similar to you, Marty, I was looking at photos of myself like as a 4-year-old, and I think I posted something on Instagram and everyone was like, oh my God, you had muscles back then. Both my parents were athletes. My dad was a hockey player and a wrestler. My mom was a gymnast. And so, yes, I came out of the womb with muscles. That's just how it was. And, you know, when you're a little kid, it's cool. You can do more pull-ups than all the boys. And in middle school, everyone's like, yeah, like she did it. And you're feeling like amazing, right? And then, you know, you get a little bit older and then you get to high school and you're like, wait a second, this isn't cool. Like, I don't want to have all these muscles. Like, I want to look like feminine. And I felt like my friends in high school looked like these like grown, blossomed, like high school, like college kids as sophomores. Like, they all had boobs and they all like had long hair. And I was just still this like stocky athlete. And so I was really insecure about, you know, going shopping. Going jean shopping was the worst because, you know, my waist is small, but I had thighs. So finding a brand that worked, and it would always end in tears. Like, it was like the worst thing for me and my mom to go jean shopping. And so, you know, I just remember those moments and my mom being like, yeah, but think about what your body can do. Like, all of your friends at school, you know, they play other sports and that's great for them, but look at what your body is able to do. Like, you're you just made the national team when you're 12. Like you can do all these skills. You can do all the, you wouldn't be able to do that if you didn't have these muscles. And so she was always very constant in my ear with all of those. And I think, you know, you say something enough times maybe, and then it begins to stick. And then it became my verbiage of like, you know, in high school, it's like, okay, you know, I don't look like everybody else. Everyone has their own body, but you know, here are the things, like whenever I would feel down or bad about it, I'm like, here are the things that my body can do. You know, I can do this event and these skills and compete at this level, and I'm appreciative. And like, that's the path that I'm on with my body. And so focusing on like the great things that I could do that was unique, helped me cope with the fact that, you know, I didn't look like everybody else. Now I think it's cool. And, you know, we all grow up and we think it's great that we have muscles and maybe you don't have to work as hard as everybody else who's trying to get a muscular body at our age. But, you know, going through that shift of like when everyone's body's changing to like become a woman and you're not, you haven't done that yet. I mean, it does process a little bit different where you're like, okay, I have to focus on the things that A, are my goals. Like my goal wasn't to be the best looking 14-year-old, my goal was to make the Olympic team. And so I think I would have acted differently if that was my goal. So if we can help athletes focus on their goals in sport versus the conversation about body in general at all, I think that would really help because it's impossible to think two things at once. So focusing on that, I think really helped me get through those times.
I heard a lot of tangible takeaways there. I mean, even an exercise that coaches can do with their athletes and have them write down the things that they appreciate, you know, that their body can do rather than what it looks like. You know, what does your body do? What does it help you do? And how does that relate to your goals and where you're trying to go? So thank you so much for that. I mean, we have a lot of coaches that are tuning in from all over the world. And, you know, at PCA, we do want coaches to strive to win and compete. We think that's very important, but we always talk about the influential platform that coaches and leaders have in the lives of youth and their development beyond just the X's and O's, right? And we really want coaches to, you know, help develop those life skills that will contribute to better humans, ones that are loved and feel valued and seen and heard. So, I would like to ask this next question. I think, Kathy, I'm going to direct it to you. How can coaches and parents and caregivers help athletes with developing a deeper understanding of their body's unique strengths and limitations as well? And how might this knowledge contribute to better decision-making when they're out there on the field or in the arena?
Sure. It's so wonderful to hear Sam's story because I can totally relate to you, Sam. You know, I was arm wrestling the boys in fifth and sixth and seventh grade. And then all of a sudden, you know, you get to high school, like you said, and on tennis, you know, you're like in a fishbowl. It's just you out there in front of these big, you know, crowds. And, you know, so you are a little self-conscious of how you look and how you feel. And so it was great to see. But like you, I had such a great support system. My parents, my family, my coaches, they were wonderful. And that's wonderful to hear for you as well. So, yeah, I think, you know, embracing and appreciating the functional capabilities of your body is extremely important for success. You know, I've been very blessed and fortunate to have played and now coached at the highest level. And I think for me, I focus on proper training on and off the court, meaning focus on the things that we can control. So that's proper nutrition, proper hydration, proper training, proper sleep. And I think if athletes are doing these things, they're going to feel better. They're going to feel healthier. Their appearance, you know, their attitude about their appearance, they're going to feel very comfortable with that. And then it's going to improve the results. They're going to feel better. You know, when you feel better on court or in your sport, usually your results are a reflection of that. So, you know, we always ask the athletes at a very young age, we're always educating them with the nutrition. And I think a lot of people forget about sleep. And sleep is, you know, really feeds everything else. So, you know, we're always constantly now with the phones and the computers and FaceTime and the games, you know, it's really important that the athletes are getting proper sleep and fueling their body for the next day of competition or next day of training. So all of those things are within your control. And I think those are the things that we have to really focus on. And, you know, I think with our younger athletes, it's constantly educating them, educating their parents, educating the private sector of coaches, that they are looking into all those things and that they are taking care of their nutrition and all of those important things to be a great athlete.
Yes, absolutely. Focusing on those things that are within their control.
Right.
So, so important. And the things that you listed and shared there are great examples of what athletes can do to help them reshift and focus on some of those things as well. And we know that sports has such a unique power to, you know, help young women, especially, right, with self-confidence and their self-advocacy and decision-making abilities, et cetera. I would love to hear maybe a personal story or experience where you or athletes that you've coached shifted their perspective to focus on what their body could do or achieve in sport, you know, leading to improved self-confidence and performance. Let's start with Tasha on this one and then open it up if anyone else has anything else to add.
Yeah, no, Marty, I am like over here, like head nodding, like so much in terms of relating to you with the arms and the muscular. I mean, I grew up feeling like I was a boy. And when you're in high school, it's like, okay, how am I going to find a boy that likes me if I look like a boy, you know? And I definitely feel my first thing was find a role model. And my role model, Serena Williams. I mean, look at her muscular build, the way that she carried herself, the way that she was able to perform on the court because of how powerful she was and how strong she was. That made me realize, well, shoot, if Serena Williams has big muscles and is able to achieve success because of the way that she looks, like, man, like, imagine if I really embraced these muscles and I had muscles everywhere, like maybe too many muscles. And I think that's one way is, you know, obviously finding a role model. That's like the easy thing. And obviously I love what you said, Sam, of just being able to write down those things. But I don't know if I necessarily ever went through an activity of actually like writing down like, okay, this is why I'm able to achieve success. But I will share one experience at UCLA. And Marty, maybe relate, but we have our testing and we have to lift and we have to see how much we can squat and how fast we can do a 20-yard dash. And we have to do a vertical jump, all of these things. And it took this one particular year that I tested top and all of these, and it was all pure physical ability. And I was able to translate, okay, like these are the reasons why I'm able to translate this into our game of I am a strong athlete, and to be able to embrace it. And I think just having that connection of being able to embrace and having that mindset of like, this is why I can kill it on the softball field. I think that changed everything for me.
I love that. I love that. And it keeps you, you know, keeps things in perspective and keeps your eye on the prize. When you have bigger goals and you have places that you want to go and achieve, knowing that this relates to that and it helps you get there is really important.
I also just wanted to jump in and add here because we've got so many amazing athletes on this call, and I am someone who is not an athlete and was one of the girls who dropped out of sport during adolescence and have since got back into movement as an adult. And I want to flag one of the antidotes to kind of low body confidence is this focus on body functionality and all the amazing stories we've heard about what our bodies can do and how we can perform. And I also want to flag that another benefit of body functionality, because, you know, for some of us, we're never going to be the Olympians and we're never going to be the best, you know, the kind of most high performing people. And so there are the small incremental gains that you can make along the way when you don't compare yourself to other people, when you're focusing on your own journey. But also the other aspects of body functionality, I think, are really important here when it comes to even just sensory experiences. When we talk to girls about playing sport and about movement, and particularly for the ones who don't thrive in terms of competition and performance, but maybe more there for the other social aspects or other well-being aspects, one of the things that they tell us is that the sensory experiences that they have during sport, or actually during incidental movement even in their lives, so the feeling of wind on their face when they're running, what they're seeing around them in the environments when they're working out, the social connection and those aspects. And they're all aspects of body functionality. So when we focus on the function of our bodies, not only does it allow us to perform, but to receive those other benefits that we get from movement and sport. And one of the other things for me personally, and what we also see in the research, is that by focusing on the function of our bodies, we also start to trust our bodies more. So for me, as I said, I dropped out of sport. I played netball and I swam in Australia when I was in primary elementary school. Got to secondary school, and you know, I wasn't like amazing at netball, and I wasn't in the A team and all of those things, and I never saw people who looked like me playing sport on TV or being successful. I just didn't think that I was a sporty person. And it wasn't until in later life I got into strength training, and I actually do powerlifting now, and I absolutely love it. And the things that I love about it is that when I'm doing that, I just have to pay attention to my body, because I'm trying to read the cues of my trainer. I'm trying to focus on, she's like saying, try and move this, try and do this. So I'm really connecting with my body in that moment and focusing on what it's doing. So I can't think about what's happening at work. I can't worry about other stuff. I'm in that moment, which provides a kind of almost meditation and rest. Also, I had scoliosis when I was younger, and I've had spinal fusion. And if you had told me, like, in 20, you'll be like deadlifting, you know, 120 kilograms, I wouldn't have believed you. But by that movement and listening to my body, honoring it, not going too far, trusting it and what it can do, I'm amazed at what I'm achieving performance wise. But I've got such a renewed sense of trust in my body, that my body can do these things. Also, sometimes if we overfocus on performance, it can also reinforce ableism. That's a risky territory with body functionality, because if we get too much into the idea of what our bodies can do, you know, for some of us, we're not going to be able to do certain things for a variety of reasons. We've all got different abilities. But by having that holistic view of body functionality, there's space in that for everyone to pay attention. And we've even done research with groups of people who have chronic health conditions. So like rheumatoid arthritis, for example, women who experience that and experience a lot of pain in their bodies, or may have gone through illness or chronic illness. And how do they find appreciation for their body's functions? Because sometimes our bodies are not going to do the things that we want it to do, despite our best efforts. And it's finding out those other attributes around body trust, the sensory experiences that are pleasant that we can feel. You know, I love when I powerlift, I take up space and it almost feels quite subversive. These are not traditionally feminine positions that I'm getting in. We're always taking up less space. That taking up more space feels very empowering to me. So those are all the other aspects that we can think holistically about when we're trying to increase that focus on body functionality for our athletes as well.
Thank you so much, Dr. Philippa. Like, that is so important and needed to be said. I know that there's so many coaches tuning in today, and most, if not all, aren't coaching the next Olympic athlete. So we do need to understand and know the other benefits that they're getting for participating in sports, those sensory benefits, you know, being able to focus, the brain development, you know, practicing controlled pressure situations, and just having that holistic view of body appreciation is so important. So I really thank you for sharing that. And we did mention also in the beginning of this, body comparison, and that can be a common challenge among athletes, especially for young girls. Sometimes, you know, coaches and parents will even say, like, that's your competition, or she's your competition, making it extremely hard for athletes not to compare themselves to the girl next to us, right? So we'd love to know, how can athletes be encouraged to compete while also celebrating their individual body functionality and appreciate their own progress without comparing themselves to others. Sam, do you want to try that one?
Yeah, I really love what Natasha said earlier about finding a role model. She said that and I was like, wow, that I forgot that that's something that I did, because in the sport of gymnastics, usually you have two different types of body styles, more the classical old school style, very skinny, very slim, lean, flexible. You know, those are kind of attributes of one style. Then you have more muscular, fit, athletic, aggressive, dynamic, that's kind of the other one. And so you kind of fit into one or two, and that usually dictates the style of gymnastics that you have. And a perfect gymnast is one of two. So if you're one, you're always trying to get a little bit of the other. And if you're more muscular, you're always trying to get more flexible. And so I think, you know, grass is always greener in that regard. And I think it was really hard for me because I was so much that muscular type of athlete that, you know, to reach my peak and potential and my goals in the sport, I really needed to come a little bit closer to the center. But thinking it more from a tactical approach and not a vanity aspect of like, you need to look like this. It was like, hey, you can look like how you look. Let's just increase these drills and these skills to help your flexibility here. And so it helped me redirect instead of comparing my body to maybe the other style of gymnastics. It was like, I can be my body and have all the strengths that my body can do, which maybe these other athletes cannot do. I can have this strength and also just get better in a lot of the aspects of the flexibility department. How am I going to do that? All right, whenever I got injured, I would stretch like 3 hours a day. I would do everything in my power to kind of like increase that. And so focusing it on it from a skill perspective and not a body perspective was something that helped me personally of like, okay, yeah, factually, your bodies look different, right? But it doesn't need to be a good or a bad thing. It's just a neutral aspect. And instead of like, I think for coaches, instead of focusing on the look of something, it's like functionality. We keep going back to that is like functionality. Yeah, there are skills in certain sports that are better and that you can improve. So how can we improve the functionality of the skills in the sport? So I think really focusing on that aspect of it rather than the look or the aesthetic of a body is really important.
Yes, absolutely. Anyone else have anything to add to that? Just on just tips for coaches or parents to help their athletes and young girls not compare themselves to the next person.
Yeah, I would just say just really focusing, you know, obviously when you're talking about the end game or results, like there's so many different ways to get results. And when you're focusing on strengths, the way I achieve success may be completely different than that competitor and how we get there. And so I think, you know, especially now coaching young ladies, like as a hitter, yeah, we could be bigger and more powerful, and I can still be smaller and use more of my body to achieve a home run. You know, a home run looks different from two different hitters. And so I just think, you know, definitely not focusing on the end result, but to get to the end result can look so different for so many different athletes, and it could be based off of different body types. And so that doesn't, just because you're one way doesn't, I guess, limit you or count you out to get those end results.
Yeah. And
Go ahead, Sam.
Sorry, I had one more thought, especially for coaches. And I don't know how it is in other sports, but in gymnastics, if our coaches were to have us do more conditioning or something, we would automatically assume it was because of how we looked a lot of the times. And so a lot of what I talk to coaches now is just explaining the why. Why are we doing this? You know, it's like, why do I need to eat breakfast before we come to practice? Well, it's to fuel your body so that your body can reach its full potential. Why are we doing extra conditioning? Well, because you're putting a floor routine together and you need more endurance. It's not because we think that, you know, you look fat or you're out of shape or all these things. It's to help your function in the sport. And I think that at least in the sport of gymnastics, that's what's historically been lacking. It is that someone or a coach would just say, do this, and not give a reason. And so it allows the athletes to make up that reason of why. So I think if you just take away the question marks of like, hey, go the extra mile of like, we're doing this because we want you to be in the best shape and it's going to make your meet, game, competition easier on the weekend if we put in a little bit more here. End of story. So I think that that helps a lot too with athletes.
And I would just add on that, we find it very important to ask the athletes, why do you think we're doing this, and let them answer. And that way we can get information from them and what they're thinking, and really observing our athletes too. Not always over coaching and telling them every little thing to do, because in tennis, it's so important to be a great problem solver. So I think that that is something that we really focus on as coaches, is observing, asking a lot of questions, and seeing how much knowledge they are picking up. Because at the end of the day, we're looking for strong, independent young women that can rely on themselves and don't have to rely on a coach, that they feel like they can step on that playing ground and they're confident in themselves. That's really a big part of the philosophy that we use. And then just to add also on pathways, you know, there's just so many different pathways with the comparisons. When you talk about comparing, and how easy that is for even parents to compare, you know, one athlete to another, I think that happens quite a bit, actually, or coaches ourselves. And we have to really be careful with that, because, you know, what we always say, and what I always try to instill in parents and coaches and the athletes that I work with, that everybody has their own pathway. My pathway is very different from somebody else's pathway. I happened to turn pro at 14 before I was even in high school, but that's not going to be the pathway of somebody else. So, you know, but it doesn't mean they can't get to the same top of the game, or, you know, be the best in the world because they took a different pathway. So I think it's really important to instill that pathway. You write your own story, you write your own pathway. And really, at the end of the day, is, you know, I just had this conversation with an athlete. At the end of the day, it doesn't really matter what I'm thinking, what everybody's got an opinion, what other people think. It's really what's in what you think of yourself out there. You know, if you see yourself, do you visualize yourself at the top of the game? Do you visualize yourself shaking hands, winning that match, and believing in yourself? I think Coco Gauff just said it brilliantly at the Australian Open. I'm going to bet on myself. And I love that. I love to hear a young athlete. She's such a great role model. And Natasha, you mentioned Serena Williams. Well, she's absolutely incredible. I got to captain her on the Billie Jean King Cup team, and I learned so much from her and grew up with her, practiced with her in Venus. And you're right, she's an incredible role model for us, and the confidence and just being around. If anybody can be around her and Venus, I mean, they are brilliant. And they just have that inner confidence in themselves. So I just think those are the points that I just wanted to add on to.
Yes, absolutely. And I just want to reiterate a couple of things that you all mentioned. I mean, understanding that there's different pathways and different definitions of success for every person. You know, it does not look the same. Goals are different. There's no one way to achieve something. And I think coaches need to understand that they have to get to know their athletes individually and understand what their needs are, understand what their specific goals are, where they're trying to get. And then we have to provide them the steps and tools to meet those expectations that they're setting for themselves. So I think that's really important. And then the second thing that Kathy mentioned was providing athletes with voice and choice. Making them a part of that decision-making process is a great way that coaches can help, you know, young girls really feel seen, feel heard, feel that sense of voice that they really do need. And sports can provide that for them. So I just wanted to reiterate those things that you all mentioned. Now, I do always talk about those tangible takeaways that coaches can use, like tomorrow when they're in front of their girls and they're at practice. So let's think about some specific mental exercises or mindfulness techniques that you've used or you've seen use to help redirect their attention away from appearance and toward their body's sensations and experiences during sports. I know Dr. Philippa has some tools from the actual resources that we're going to be sharing with coaches after. If you want to share some mental exercises that coaches can do.
Yeah, absolutely. So throughout Body Confidence Sport, which is three modules that coaches can take their athletes through, in every module, we do what's called a three-step sense check. And really, this is an opportunity. It's quite simple. I actually like doing it myself. And, you know, I might just quickly guide you through it now because it shows you just how simple it is. But it offers us a moment to focus on the function of our bodies and to connect with our bodies. So, you know, invite you to close your eyes or just soften your gaze a little bit right now. And take 3 deep breaths in through your nose and out through your mouth. Now I want you to just gently scan down your body from the top of your head all the way down to your feet, just noticing what feelings do you have, what sensations do you have in your body? Is there anything that a part of your body needs right now? And then finally, thinking about moving forward, which could be something that you might be able to do right now or when we finish this webinar, is thinking, what is an action that you can take to meet something that your body was asking for? So is it taking a sip of water? Is it stretching, moving your shoulders, getting up and moving around, and to honor that? That is a really simple exercise that we call the 3-step sense check, checking in with your body, noticing how it's feeling, what it needs, and then honoring that need by taking that step to move it. So that's one of the simple tools that, you know, people can use throughout the day. You can also use it, you know, during break time, during in between while you're playing, is connecting with your body. It's a very grounding experience. It's also an opportunity to check in. So much of the time we're up here in our heads, thinking about all the things, attending to the cues that are going on in the environment. That's a really simple way to connect with your body and the functions of your body and then take steps to do it. One of the other brilliant techniques, and this applies not just in the movement context, but more broadly. And that's also really important to know that by investing in your athlete's body confidence, you're not just investing in how they're going to show up when they're playing sport and moving their bodies. But we know that body confidence affects all key areas of girls and women's lives. So it affects their physical and mental health more broadly. It also affects their relationships. There's research from Dove that show 8 out of 10 girls opt out of important life activities like going to the doctor, putting their hand up in the classroom and giving an opinion because of low body confidence. And fortunately, one of the key techniques that I recommend across all of the work that I do, which is included in body confidence sport and suits this environment really well, is an exercise where we focus on body appreciation. If we start to appreciate what our bodies can do and the functions of our bodies, we start to see our bodies as more complex. They're not just these outer shells to be looked at by other people. They are complex, they are doing lots of different things, and we can use them in lots of different ways. And when we practice gratitude for that, it's an opportunity for us to focus on that. And then with that complexity, we are more likely to see our bodies as tools and instruments. And when we see our bodies as tools and instruments and listen to them and respect them, we have body confidence. So one of the exercises as well in body confidence sport is a really short journaling exercise. We get girls to write this down, but actually you can do it, you know, you could record a voice note on your phone, you could just tap it into your phone, and it's a really brief prompt. We could all do this. Doing it a couple of times over a week has been shown in research to be really beneficial to body confidence. And it's basically just writing down, taking 5 minutes to write down, what am I grateful for that my body allows me to do? In body confidence sport, we get girls in particular, they've got a workbook, and we get them to focus on, when you're playing sport, what are you grateful for that your body allows you to do? And it might be to have awareness of strategy going on in your head and being a few steps ahead while you're moving your body. It might be the strength of your legs, the power of your arms, the kind of your heart racing and your body to regulate your temperature. When you're focusing on that, it's really hard, as Sam said, to think about 2 things at once. It recenters you and the functions of your body. And then finally, one of the things I really like to recommend, we've already talked about role models a lot. We've got some amazing role models on this call. So helping girls and athletes identify role models in their lives. And we've heard about Serena Williams talk about, and I actually sat on a panel with Venus Williams recently for the launch of Body Confidence Sport. And she commented on, you know, how amazing her sister is. Obviously, we all know what she has done and achieved. And she said how much and how much commentary Serena Williams has received about her body and that it's more masculine. Lots of the things that Tasha and Marty, you've said, and probably, you know, we've all experienced in various ways. We've got these tools with body confidence sport, but we also need to be thinking about how we change the environment for girls. How do we create more role models for girls and athletes? And female athletes are an amazing source of this, where women are celebrated and girls are celebrated for what their bodies can do. So reducing commentary on the appearance of athletes in, you know, mainstream media, online, on social media, and encouraging girls to think about the role models in their life, seek out the role models. But also one of the things I just like people to reflect on is think about the people you most admire in life that might be on the field or off the field. And if we think about them, I guarantee that it's got nothing to do with how they look. It's about something else. It's about their level of kindness. It's about their achievements in life. It's about, you know, how, you know, the gold medals they've won. It's about how funny they are. It's about how they make us feel and make us feel loved. So role models are really important, both for what their bodies can do, but all of those other attributes as well, because that's an opportunity for us to create this culture where we're focusing on what people can do and the functions of their bodies rather than those outer shells.
So well said. So well said, Dr. Philippa. I'm just thinking right now about the environment and how impactful that is and how it starts with us as adults and role models for our youth. The way we talk about our bodies, the way that we look at ourselves is going to be impactful for them as well. So we definitely need to self-check. And then I was also thinking about when you mentioned, you know, making sure that young women have role models and they're able to feel a sense of love and empowerment and everything. We also want to think about the peer-to-peer interactions. How do we get the environment within their teams where girls are talking well about one another and also helping to contribute to this positive environment when it comes to body confidence? Do we want to provide some examples of how girls can talk to each other about this? Or are we maybe saying, let's stay away from talking or commenting about girls' bodies at all? Does anyone have any advice for that, for coaches, how we can help with those peer-to-peer interactions? This is open to the entire group.
You know, Marty, I think, you know, at the USTA, we've really tried to build a strong culture amongst the players. And I think everybody's brought this point up, which is so great, including, you know, Natasha, starting with Serena Williams, having a role model. And I think it's important to have mentors. So we like maybe our older athletes to give back and to mentor some of our young ones. And now they're just doing that naturally. And, you know, it's just so wonderful to see our American players really cheering and supporting one another. You know, when I first started coaching, we didn't really have that culture. And I give the players so much credit because they really are, it's like a healthy competition now. They're pushing each other. You know, back in my time, you know, when I first was starting out at 14, it was Martina and Chrissy. And Martina Navratilova was the one that kind of started lifting and, you know, brought fitness into tennis. And then that kind of raised the bar for Chris Everett. And so she started working on her fitness, and that kind of raised the bar for everybody. And so I think it became like a healthy competition that way. And I think, you know, for the athletes to be able to give back to the sport that, you know, gives us all so much in our lives by taking time with the younger ones and being able to talk to them and lead by example.
Absolutely. Having like that big sister relationship, or maybe an upperclassman who really pours into the younger classmen. I think that's important. There's a concept that we teach at PCA called filling the emotional tank and showing appreciation to one another, making sure your teammate knows that you care and that you love them, you see them, you value them for what they can do and how they make you feel rather than how they look, right? I think that's really important. And I think there's one other thing I want to dive into before we wrap up today. I mean, we understand that sports is a huge opportunity to practice failure and bouncing back after mistakes. Sports is a gift when it comes to that. I think that's probably the biggest life lesson that I learned from sports. I always say that sports is the safest place for our kids to fail and learn from those experiences. So I would love to know, how can the appreciation of body functionality positively affect an athlete's resilience and mental toughness, especially in the face of challenges or setbacks, which we all know are bound to happen in sports and in life, right? Tasha, let's start with you here.
Yeah, no, when you talk about failure, I just think it's, you know, you so quickly realize that not necessarily like you can't control the failure, but you can control how you react to it. You can control what your next steps are. So does that mean that I get back in the gym and I'm going to take more reps? But I love being able to control the journey, and in the sense of I can't control the outcome, but I can control what I do next. I can control how I'm going to have my at bat, my next at bat. Am I going to move in the back? Am I going to have a wider stance? What are my adjustments? And I think that that's what sport, the thing that I love about sport, that you can make those physical adjustments to hopefully change the results or, you know, to change the outcome. But I think really having that mindset that I can control what I do next is such a really powerful thing.
Yes, controlling the controllables is something my coach would always mention. Any other advice on bouncing back after mistakes and how positive body functionality and appreciating our bodies can help us be more resilient when it comes to those setbacks? Sam?
Yeah, I think body language is something we haven't talked about today that is so important in sport and life. You know, you get nervous going to a job interview. Who are you going to hire? Somebody that walks in looking down with their shoulders shrugged over? Or are you going to, you know, automatically the confidence that someone portrays, whether they feel it wholeheartedly internally or not, if you portray yourself in a confident way, generally speaking, you're going to gain confidence from that. So I think, you know, all sports have this in general. And I think maybe gymnastics and tennis is probably heightened a little bit more. When you walk up to the judge and you salute, is your chest up? Is your chin down? Like, that sort of body language in sport really gives you the confidence, even if you're not feeling it 100% right then. So practicing that definitely correlates to your life outside of sport. So I think the conversation around confidence in general, and like, how can your body help you gain confidence and those life lessons? And we can, you know, we could do a whole presentation on the laundry list of all those body language, but I think just in general, thinking through what that means in your individual sports and how you can teach your athletes to portray confidence both in and out of practice and competition.
Thank you for sharing that very important point. And I do want to open it up just in case anyone wanted to add anything before I close it out here, knowing that our time is coming up. Just want to give every panelist an opportunity to share anything else that hadn't been shared yet, and allow you the space to do so now. All right, great. Sam, Tasha, Kathy, Dr. Philippa, a heartfelt thank you and appreciation to each one of you for your generosity in sharing your insights, your experiences, your expertise with us today. I mean, your contributions have been invaluable to this crucial conversation. And I know so many coaches are going to benefit from this. And we've all gained tangible insights and takeaways on guiding athletes to shift their focus from how their bodies look to embracing and appreciating what their bodies can do. And we know that recognizing and celebrating their diverse abilities and attuning to those bodies' needs are very important during sports. And it's a transformative approach that we can all embrace as coaches and leaders and parents and caregivers. So I do want to just say thank you again. And I also want to highlight the extraordinary body confidence sport module for coaches and the dedicated tool for female athletes. It's nothing short of incredible. And I'm going to share my screen again Please take out your phones as you're tuning in and download the tool right now so you can access this today. This is very, very useful for coaches and for parents to use with their young athletes. And let us know what you think of the tool. Let us know what you think. We'll be sharing this out after the recording, as well as a follow-up survey where you can provide us feedback on the tool and on these webinars as well. We'll have one more webinar coming up in March, so stay tuned as we dive into the last and final topic of the Body Confident Athlete sessions. So we'll be sending that information out as well. But I do want to just say thank you to everyone that tuned in today. Your time is very appreciative, and we really, really look forward to the next time that we're all together. Thank you so much, and have a great evening.